It appears that we have both counsel here for our remaining argued case this morning. Dimry versus Bert Bell, Pete Rozelle, NFL Player Retirement Plan. And Mr. Meehan, I believe you are going first. Oh, wait, we've lost one of the lawyers. Wait. You're there. Okay.
Oh, yeah. Sorry, Your Honor.
Go for it. You're on, sir.
Your Honor, I actually, the reason I disappeared for a second, I apologize. I realized I left my jacket. I was about to put it back on, so I apologize for that, but I didn't want to delay us.
You may proceed as is.
All right. Thank you for the courtesy. May it please the court. Edward Meehan on behalf of the plan defendants. The case today is not about whether... Oh, and I apologize. I was going to ask for 3 minutes to reserve on my time for rebuttal, if I may.
You'll have to keep watch on your time, but you may have that.
Thank you. The case today is not about whether Mr. Dimry is entitled to disability benefits. He is. He's already receiving them. He's been receiving them for years. The question here is whether he is deserving under the procedures and requirements of the plan to be upgraded to the next level. And on that, the board came to the conclusion after multiple reviews and the outside input of several doctors to determine that he was not qualified.
Counsel, the thing that concerns me the most, and obviously I'm speaking only for myself in asking this question, and that is the issue, the sort of procedural issue that occurred on the remand when Dr. Jackson made his interpretation and review of the records, and this and the plan didn't explicitly give Mr. Dimry an opportunity to respond to that. And our cases seem to hold that a plan must provide a provision for dialogue under ERISA. There has to be an opportunity to respond to the sort of final rationale. So what is your response to whether there's a procedural error here, regardless of everything else?
Your Honor, we acknowledge that the cases speak of a meaningful dialogue, and we think that occurred here. If the court would look at the excerpts of record beginning at page 85 and 86, what you'll see is a two-page letter to Dr. Jackson, which is an attempt to synthesize all of the issues and concerns that had been raised by Mr. Dimry through counsel at that point. So Dr. Jackson first was directed to take a fresh look at anything and everything that was in the record. But once
he did that, was Mr. Dimry, as I understand it, was not given an opportunity to review what Dr. Jackson had looked at or had decided or interpreted about those records before the final decision was made. That's the issue. There's no problem with getting another look at it. The problem or potential problem is not giving him an opportunity to give additional input about that final look.
On these facts, Your Honor, I'd suggest there was no denial of opportunity. Obviously, the door was open at any time for contact, and we have a dispute here as to who is supposed to pick up the telephone. I get that. But in this case, because there was a long history, what Dr. Jackson had the benefit of was all of the issues that had been set forth both in front of Judge Donato.
Did the letter to and from Dr. Jackson go contemporaneously to Mr. Dimry or his counsel?
I do not believe it did, Your Honor.
How could he have had an opportunity to reply to it or give meaningful input about what Dr. Jackson thought?
Well, because the reason, Your Honor, is because the letter itself, as I say, was the attempt to synthesize all of the concerns that Mr. Dimry had already raised. So upon remand from Judge Donato, it was clear what the court was directing the plans to do. And in addition, what the plans did was synthesize all of the issues that had already been raised by Mr. Dimry. And at this point,
Dr. Jackson is a new player. How would he have any idea what Dr. Jackson was going to think of those records and those issues without being brought in contemporaneously?
Well, what our view is that what Mr. Dimry had already done, it provided that input. So it wasn't as if Mr. Dimry needed the opportunity to raise criticisms or concerns. That had already taken place. And we presented all of those criticisms and concerns to Dr. Jackson. And even to date, there is nothing that has been identified that was missed in that sense. Yes, there are items that are being pointed out, which we would say are of a minor nature, not a substantive nature in terms of issues with Dr. Jackson's report. But the main focus that we are getting today, as we understand it from the Dimry side of this, is you should have, for example, looked at the Social Security Administration record. But Mr. Dimry presumably has that record, has not identified anything from that record that would have made any difference here. So to the extent there is any issue with an opportunity, we would say first on the facts of this case, because of the long history, that meaningful dialogue already took place. And second, if we look at it from a, was there an impact? Was there a consequence? Nothing has been identified at this point that we could have taken into account that might in any way have affected the decision. And that's one of the reasons, actually, when we're asked to speak to the Social Security Administration result, that was, first of all, Judge Donato did not direct the plans to do that. He frankly said, you may want to. That was his quote. And it was considered, it was taken into account. And what has not been perhaps given enough focus is if in the excerpt of record at page 65, which is part of the ALJ's opinion at the SSA level, what he pointed out, what the ALJ pointed out was, and I'll quote, it says, the state agency medical consultants found insufficient evidence to make a determination regarding the claimant's impairments and functioning. And then it continued. And the ALJ indicated the undersigned, meaning the ALJ, cannot give any weight to the medical consultant's opinions. So what we see here, if we look at Dr. Jackson's report, he looked at Dr. Chen, he looked at Dr. Meyer. He obviously did his own analysis of what was available in the record. He looked at the SSA report. He speaks of that. We have Drs. Purcell, Dr. Miller, Mr. Snow, all of whom had opinions which varied, shall we say, from Dr. Murphy.
Can you explain the interaction between Social Security benefits and the plan benefits? From what I understand, Mr. Dimry is receiving inactive benefits because his Social Security request was denied twice and was then granted while the plan application was pending. What if he had the Social Security had granted his request and then he filed his request with the plan? What would the result be at that point?
He would have been deemed automatically eligible under the way the plan works. The issue here really is the timing. That's why I started out saying this case is not about whether Mr. Dimry is qualified for benefits. He is, and he's receiving them. It's what level of benefit. It's the time period. If he had...
Does that suggest that maybe, the board should have scrutinized the Social Security decision? If it's a matter of mere timing and they should have scrutinized the Social Security ruling when they finally granted it after two denials a little bit more carefully?
Your Honor, I would suggest two reasons why the answer would be no. One is the plan is very clear that the SSA determination is meaningful based upon its timing. And because the determination came after the 15th year following the end of the last credited season, basically his last season in pro ball, Dr. Jackson did look at the SSA determination and reviewed what was available. And what I was noting was when one looks at what the ALJ mentioned, it is clear that under the SSA, because they have a different rule and they have a law to follow, that does not apply to the plans, they had to defer to the treating physician. Dr. Murphy is the outlier. And so SSA had to defer to him, as the ALJ said, as I just indicated. He cannot give any weight to the medical consultants from the SSA. So if we were to look even at any detail that was in that record that for some reason we hadn't, it would only be telling us that Dr. Murphy is still the outlier. So there are multiple reasons why we think the SSA determination would not really apply here. I know there's also, briefly I'll touch on, there are issues here about, alleged conflicts. This set of plans is no stranger to litigation, and multiple courts have had these plans in front of them. And no one has suggested that there is any structural conflict here. Beyond, I know the issue that Judge Donato pointed out, but as the case has come forward from Judge Corley, there is no conclusion of any conflict. And in fact, we have set the multiple district courts from the District of Maryland who have examined and rejected the exact theory by which there is supposedly a conflict here with the plans. Overall, we would say it was really a very thorough and detailed review. This is a case, I hate to use the phrase, but it is so apt. This is Monday morning quarterbacking. And we're having, an examination for a detail here and a detail there. And there's an awful lot of strong language in terms of, the approach that was taken here, but yet no flaw beyond, very minor issues that don't appear to go to the substance, has been raised. These plans take their duties to the players and the retired players quite seriously. And just from the public information on the plans form 5500s, one can see that there are hundreds of millions of dollars and thousands of former players who have been found qualified, among them Mr. Dimry, but just at a level that is below that he seeks.
Could I ask a question about the level of benefits? Because this seems like an awful lot of litigation over this issue. And I sense that both sides are very frustrated by the amount of time and expense that's gone into this. So what's the difference between the benefit level where he is now and the level he's seeking in dollars?
Roughly speaking, it would be double.
So what's the base level?
I confess I can't give you precisely. I believe the current level is approximately $4,000, but I could be off on that particular number, but I know it would double.
So like $40,000 to $50,000 a year, maybe? Is that what we're talking about?
That's approximately correct, Your Honor, but I am sorry, I don't have that exact number at my fingertips. But it's at least a couple of thousand dollars a month. That's I believe, but I don't know that it can be much beyond that.
Okay, thank you.
And I see I've eaten into the time I have reserved. So
you may reserve the remainder.
Thank you, Your Honor.
And we'll hear now from Mr. Coleman.
Yes, good morning. May it please the court and counsel. The district court gave the NFL exactly what it wanted here, which is a review for a straightforward abuse of discretion. But what the district court found, they come here, the NFL comes here not wanting to do what the district court said should be done, which is to ask its medical director whether, given Mr. Dimry's subjective reports of pain, and given that there is no objective evidence requirement, is he disabled? They don't want to ask their doctor that. And in fact, they don't even want they appeal not wanting to have to answer that question. And then they also put in their briefs that if this court affirms the district court's decision that there was an abuse of discretion, they don't even want it remanded to them. They want—
Well, counsel, let me ask, that gives rise to a couple of questions in my mind. The first one is similar to one that I asked your colleague, And that is, if we were to determine that there's a procedural error with respect to the opportunity to review and respond to Dr. Jackson's final analysis or report, or however you want to describe it, the argument on the other side is basically there's nothing new there, so there would be nothing new to be said. So there's already been complete dialogue. What's your response to that?
Oh, there's a lot new there. There, Dr. Jackson put in his first report that if objective evidence is required, then he wouldn't, then he finds that there's not significant objective evidence to corroborate. But the policy here doesn't require that. And in his second report, there was concession after concession after concession by Dr. Jackson that pain is not predictable, that the level of the pain doesn't always corroborate with the objective findings with respect to degenerative disc disease, that it varies from individual to individual, which is exactly why Judge Corley said, ask him the right question. You have to ask him the right question. That is a question that they have never asked anyone, in particular, Dr. Jackson. And on this subject, what Judge Corley noted was, well, if Mr. Dimry's counsel had an opportunity to respond to this and to provide some input to the board, maybe the board would finally get it. That's essentially what she indicated. Now, there was no meaningful dialogue that took place here. What I heard counsel say was that they had a meaningful dialogue among themselves. That isn't what the Ninth Circuit says. The Ninth Circuit says you have to have a meaningful dialogue with the claimant.
Now, so let me ask you the other question that was raised by your comments, and that is the plan's desire to see an end to this. I don't view that as a concession myself, just again speaking for myself, as to anything other than this has been a protracted litigation and it's time to find a resolution one way or another. In your view, would a permissible outcome, I want you to assume for the sake of this question that you find a procedural irregularity in the lack of opportunity to respond to Dr. Jackson, would it be permissible in your view to direct the district court to allow Mr. Dimry to respond to Dr. Jackson's report and then make a final decision itself as a court that he is or is not entitled to benefits?
Yes, in fact, what we think should be done is based on the record, the district court should be issuing a final decision as opposed to a remand.
Mr. Meehan can respond, but I take it that he would find that an acceptable, assuming that we were to find an error, that would be an acceptable resolution in terms of the bottom line from their point of view as well, just to put an end to this.
Are you asking?
Well, I'm going to ask him when it's his turn to comment on that as well.
If I could follow up on that, if it went back to the district court for a decision on whether Mr. Dimry is entitled to benefits, what standard would the district court use? Because under the plan documents, there's really no space for a court to make that finding.
Yes, thank you, Your Honor. So the district court has already found that there is an abuse of discretion. So the determination by the NFL, assuming affirmance that an abuse of discretion has taken place here, now the district court judge would be empowered to make the decision. is this individual who's been declared disabled by the Social Security Administration and based on the totality of the record, is he entitled to his benefits? Is he disabled? As whether it's called de novo, that is the decision that the court would be empowered to make.
As I understand it, the Saffron versus Wells Fargo case suggests that the district court can make this as a final decision.
Yes, absolutely. And this comes up, unfortunately, frequently, in terms of what happens after a district court has declared, has found there to be an abuse of discretion. And serial denials with repeat litigation, like what has transpired here, is the problem. Greater guidance and direction to our district courts, empowering them upon an abuse of discretion to make these decisions, will inure to the benefit of not only the claimants, but as well as we can see from the plans themselves that also do not want protracted litigation. Nobody wants this. Mr. Dimry filed this back in 2014. We've been in litigation in this matter since 2016. Two times the NFL has been found to have abused its discretion. And there are significant concerns regarding giving the NFL further leeway to make determinations here. When we found out, not only that we weren't advised about Dr. Jackson or what was going on behind the scenes, and we were provided the minutes of the meetings that showed that litigation counsel, the defense counsel that we were litigating against, was invited and participated at the board meetings two times. Meanwhile, in that context, if he's invited as plan counsel, he's acting in a fiduciary role, not only to the plan, but also the beneficiaries. But meanwhile, he's litigation defense counsel. It was quite shocking that we were not provided any notice and that the record was reopened on a one-way street. Unless there's any further questions, Your Honor, I'm happy to submit.
I don't see any hands raised, so I think we're ready to hear again from Mr. Meehan on rebuttal.
Thank you.
Thank you, Your Honor. First, I am not representing the NFL. The NFL is not a party. The constant reference to the NFL is either a mistake or designed to provoke an image. Neither is appropriate. I represent the plans. The plans are independent. And so we need to stay focused on the analysis. And that's one of the concerns. There's a lot of histrionics here. And certainly when we're dealing with an individual who has been experiencing issues, there's naturally going to be a lot of sympathy. But our focus here is to try to be analytical. The question that counsel said we're afraid to ask is on page 86 of the record. It's question number 9, directed to Dr. Jackson. So here's the question. And this focuses on the exact concern that Mr. Dimry had raised through counsel and that was being raised again here today. It says, the discussion section of your initial summary mentions a lack of, quote, objective, end quote, evidence, but again, quotes, objective evidence of other findings. Would you expect to see that, in your view, would corroborate or better establish total and permanent disability due to, and then he names, a variety of the conditions at issue. Objective here is looking for corroborating evidence. I'm not a doctor, but it's as simple as if I'm constantly getting a sharp pain in my left arm, I'm going to tend to not use my left arm, which means my left arm will begin to atrophy and my right arm will begin to strengthen. Those are sort of corroborative efforts. And again, I'm not the doctor. I'm trying to boil it down to something very simple. That's what Dr. Jackson was asked. That's the whole focus here. It's not an objective evidence of something that is deemed to be subjective. It is, are there corroborating physical findings? And Dr. Jackson was clear in the record that there wasn't. That's what that was about. I would say, Your Honor, yes, we are actually content. If the court does not reverse and uphold the decision of the board, we are content for the district court simply to enter an award for Mr. Dimry. It has been a long road. And the record was not reopened here. Dr. Jackson simply was asked to examine the record in great detail. And the litigation counsel attending the meeting, that's planned counsel who routinely attends and participates in board meetings. There's no imagery that's appropriate that's being brought up there. Again, you know, language of serial denials and things of that nature. It's more histrionics rather than analytics. We think when this situation is analyzed carefully, it is clear that the board here attempted to do a thorough job, a careful job, and only Dr. Murphy, among all of the physicians on both sides and with the government, is the outlier. And there's no basis to upgrade Mr. Dimry to the next level. It is a matter of some importance to the plan, not just as much on an individual level, but because of the precedent it sets. And at this point, we are content for the district court to enter an award for him, which we do not believe should happen. We think it should be reversed. And we would leave it.
Thank you, counsel. You've exceeded your time, and we definitely understand both sides' positions. The case just argued is submitted, and we again appreciate very helpful comments from both of you. And with that, we are adjourned for this morning's session.
Thank you very much.
This court for this session stands adjourned.